Hebrews 5, verse 4. No man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as was Aaron. So also Christ glorified on himself to be made a high priest, but he that said unto him, Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. As he also saith in another place, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Amen. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong cries and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Amen.
Amen.
And then, next verse, verse 8, he says, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience through the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all that obey him. That's all we have. Okay. Amen. Well, today I want to share with you about two high callings of Jesus.
Amen.
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 Now, Jesus Christ was on this earth to do several things. Amen.
Amen.
But in this scripture, we see that he performed two great callings. One of them was the calling to be a son, and the other was the calling to be a priest. Amen.
Amen.
Now, in these last days of ministry and opportunity of this earth, it is those who are champions in these two callings who will do well.
Wow.
Amen.
Amen.
Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes.
You see, we have what we call the fivefold ministry, which is the popular ministry that pastor, teacher, evangelist, prophet, apostle. I don't know who made it the main five main callings of the church, or the big five. When you go to South Africa, they will show you the big five animals. The lion. When you go to on a safari, they will say, they will ask if you've got any of the big five. But I have a t-shirt, and the t-shirt is with the big five. Then the big five are the lion, the elephant, the hippo is also one of the big five. The lion, and who again? Buffalo, rhino, hippo. Well, that's what they say, but they are the big five. They have the big five. So when you go out on a safari, you don't see any of the big five, you are not happy because you wanted to see them. These are not so easy to see. Are you there? So somehow, I don't know who made them the big five, because the giraffe is taller than any of these five. You get it? And there are many other wild animals, leopards, and these are the big five. Yeah. No, but I can see something like a cheetah there. The big five. This is a big five book from South Africa. It has a buffalo, something like a cheetah, a lion, an elephant, a rhino. There's no hippo. So why is the people not in the big family. That's how it is with the callings. We have helps, we have governments, we have those that show compassion, either exalted and so on. I remember once Kenneth Hagin describing evangelists who preach without signs and wonders. He calls them exhorters. Yeah, these are exhorted, exhort people to be saved. Uh-huh. So he believed that the gift of exhortation is what we call evangelists who preach without miracles. It's the gift of exhortation. You understand? Because we are exhorting the people to be saved. A real evangelist is somebody with signs and wonders, like Philip. I'm saying Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ unto them, and the people gave heed of the things that both seen and hearing the miracles which he did. For many with an unclean spirit, and it goes on. So you see that signs and wonders were done by Philip the evangelist. You get it? And then there are many other gifts. Those who are able to govern, those who are able to help, those who are able to give, and he that giveth. They are all gifts, but we have made five of them, whatever. But I believe that the highest calling is the calling probably of a father, because that is the office that God himself occupies. He fathers us all. Our Father, which art in heaven. The ability to father a lot of people is also calling. So you notice here that Jesus Christ had, he said unto him, thou art my son. Today I have begotten thee. He said, thou art my apostle. Thou art my good shepherd. Thou art my evangelist. But thou art my son or my son. And then the next one is, thou art a priest. And these are two great callings. And I want to say to all of us that we should desire to become sons and priests.
Amen.
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 Let's take the priest for instance. A priest was someone who was dedicated to the temple. And so in our modern world, when we talk about a priest, we often think of somebody wearing this long robe and he stays in and around the church for long. And most people don't want their children to do such things. But actually, the priest is the calling that Jesus occupied. A priest. He was a priest. And he was burning, his duty was to, the priest's duty was to burn incense, make sacrifices, enter the holy place, put the bread there for 7 days, eat it after 7 days, light candles, burn incense. These are priestly jobs, which includes praying, waiting on God, coming close to God in the inner place, and so on and so forth. Are you listening to me? But we often disregard these jobs because we don't know the effect of these jobs. I was reading a book and it said, almost anybody who has had a profound effect in the ministry is someone who has been mighty in prayer. If you're going to have any good effect in the ministry, you are somebody who will be close to God through prayer, which is the work of a priest. Are you listening to me tonight? So I believe that God is calling us to this priestly job, the job of a priest, where we will spend more time about holy things. You see, the reason why we don't pray much is because we don't know what we are doing when we pray. Recently, I had a church, one of our churches. It has been stable. I started that church myself, that particular branch. It has been stable for the last 10 years, doing well. Then suddenly, the pastor of the church decided to leave the church. He was playing some games, decided to leave the church, and then start another church near our church. So when he was going, I said, well, just be careful, because when you start certain things, you will provoke a certain spirit and a certain anointing. You see a shepherd or a lion or a snake, you may see him sleeping, or even a chicken. But when you come for his children, you see that he's woken up. And then he looked very kind before, but now he looks like he's grown up. Yeah, because it's normal. Is that not so? So what I'm saying is that don't provoke a certain aspect of a shepherd's anointing. Anyway, but as I was meditating on what this boy was doing, then another pastor, who had just become a pastor, a Nigerian, also suddenly decided after some months, or a couple of years, or whatever, some period of time, to also behave in a similar way. So I was meditating on it, and then I believe that the Spirit of the Lord showed me that this boy who first left the church and went to set up a church outside opened a door in the spirit of rebellion which had not been there, because it sends a message to all possible candidates of rebellion and deception that, look, it can be done. You won't die. Nothing bad will happen to you. Do you understand? So, later I was considering this young man, and I was realizing that, you know, it's like he did something, but what he actually did spiritually was to open a certain door to disturb the churches. So sometimes we don't know what we are doing. When we do one thing, we don't know that what we are doing is other things. It's not even repercussions, but actually you are opening a certain door. But we close that door in the name of Jesus. When Jesus sent his disciples out to preach, they came back rejoicing. And they said, Lord, demons were cast out and they were subject to us in your name. And Jesus laughed at them and said, oh, you see, other things were accomplished. You didn't see. Satan, I saw Satan falling down from heaven. Not knowing that this preaching that they went to preach, you know, it was causing Satan to fall down from heaven. Which they didn't see as an effect of their mission. And then he said also, your names are written in heaven. Rejoice about that one. So you realize that they didn't know the spiritual things that were happening by their actions. That doors were being opened, making Satan fall down, and names were being established and written in heaven. So when they went back, they came back rejoicing. You see, the Apostle Paul, you may wonder, what did he accomplish by insisting on going to Rome? He had to testify, even though they didn't believe him. He opened the door of the gospel to the entire Roman Empire by going there to testify. You see, they look as though he just went to die, he didn't accomplish anything. The white people who came to die in Ekropong and other towns in this country, you may have looked at their lives, so maybe they didn't accomplish it. They came here, they were Germans, they couldn't speak Cree, they couldn't speak Ekwapim Cree, they couldn't do anything, so they just died over there, and then one of them has started a school somewhere. You don't know. They opened a door. I said they opened a door for the gospel of Jesus Christ to come into the land. an entire nation to a point where a census can declare that we have 70% Christians in our nation. To the amazement of the Muslim community. So when you see somebody doing something spiritually, it may look like nothing, like if somebody is praying. What have you done? So he went to pray. He's making noise. But actually, that's what Jesus said. Look, I was crying the heavenly things that the angels were writing your names. Satan was falling from heaven. After effects of your preaching and your mission and your trip and your traveling, after things have happened and have taken place, through your work, that's one journey that you made and you came back. That's why God has called some of you. Because he needs you, some of you, just to stand up for something, to open a particular door and to release a certain word to come to pass because of you and because of something that you will do. And that is why sometimes when you refuse to do what God has asked you to do, you don't know that because you didn't go. Give me one of the books, Win the Lost at Any Cost. Just one copy. I will read something to you that will surprise you. When they were coming to Ghana, Win the Lost at Any Cost. That's why God is calling us to be priests,
amen,
to be pastors,
amen,
to be worshippers.
Amen.
That's why we are, that place you see at the back is a prayer chapel.
Amen.
I said it's a prayer chapel. We are building a chapel of prayer. And grace of God will be multiplied in our lives. See, we don't know the effect of what we are doing. That's why we don't pray. We are willing to pray.
Yes.
Things will be different. And that is why God, one of the highest callings, because it involves such concentration that if you are not a certain kind of person, you can't pray the way prayer is. You will stop. Once you pray, when you pray, and you realize that you've just woken up, you realize, I just woke up. I was praying and I woke up. Not that you were praying and you slept, but you were praying and you woke up. That means you didn't even see when you slept. It's amazing. Zazozi. Missionaries to Ghana from Switzerland, and I'm reading from this book, Win the Lost at Any Cost. Listen to what somebody said. He was against it. He said, wouldn't it be strange if a mission was sent out from Switzerland? They were about to send them from Switzerland to Ghana. While there is such a dire need that someone rather comes to us in order to put an end to the domestic rampant paganism that is in the heads of our own nobles and commoners, smart heads and dimwits alike. He said, why should we send somebody to Switzerland, to Ghana, when we need somebody to come and put an end to the rampant domestic paganism? You know paganism? Practice of no God in Switzerland. It was a debate. And then some people said that it was dangerous. You know? To go. Concerning their health risk. And you see, they were coming to open the door. They were going to die, but they opened the door with their blood. There's dripping blood of a 25 year get all Swiss German boys and girls. They used their blood to turn the hinges of the door that didn't want to open to us and keep us all in hell. It was the door to heaven. It was the door to hell that was being closed for us and the door to heaven that was being swung open with the blood of the young boy. Go to a proposal and see their name. 24 years old, 23 years old. That's why I'm sending missionaries. The anxieties concerning their health risk were brushed off. Inspector Bloomhart, he wrote, he said, listen, look, this is the man, he had a vision. He said, we will consider it shameful to the name of Christ, to close our hearts and ears to the misery and the outcries for help of these poor souls in Africa. Just because of the dangers of death. Listen. He said, neither does the European slave trader, said, neither does the European slave trader shy away from the perils of a life-consuming climate when he roams the same shores day and night like a predator. A wolf or a lion looking for meat. And he said the European, the white man slave trader, he roams the shores. He was roaming the shores of Mabadi, Cape Coast, and Mina, looking for human beings like a wolf and looking for money. And he's not afraid to die of malaria. He's not afraid to die of the parents that were here. He said, neither shall we shy away from the dangers of preaching the gospel and going out there to do what we have to do. And he was working at Ghana Airways. And I said, then I realized that the parent of the person that I wanted to employ said that he wants to come and see me about employing his child. But I remember when this same Ghana Airways went to Rome or wherever, and when it arrived there for repair, they told them this is a flying coffin. And I asked myself that, why doesn't the parent of this child go to Ghana Airways and say, and my child or my daughter or my son cannot fly on a flying coffin every day to Gambia, Sierra Leone, Abidjan, Lagos, and come on a flying coffin? I will not allow my child to go there. But when it comes to the gospel and the church, which is despised, then you see them come and I say, I will never entertain such a parent in my office, even for 5 minutes. If the parent wants to see me about salvation, I will entertain it. But to come and discuss whether your child will work, if your child will work, carry your child away. We shall not shy away from the dangers. And that's exactly what they said. It's just 150 years ago. That's what brought the gospel to this country. The same discussions were being held. The discussions today for the salvation of more people that have ever lived on this earth are still the same. Should we shy away from the danger of sitting on a plane, of going to a plane, of going to die somewhere? Should we shy away when people are not afraid to fly day and night and to go to all kinds of places because of money and their parents will never say anything about it? But when it comes to preaching and the word of God, then see people writing up. I have no even 5 minutes to entertain such a thing. We would have considered it shameful, I'm quoting, to the name of Christ, to close our hearts to the miseries and the cries for help of these poor souls in Africa, just because we shied away from the dangers of death. Neither does the European slave trader shy away from the perils of a life-consuming climate when he roams these same shores day and night. Like a predator, a hunting man, a human man, hunting for other human beings to get them to enslave them and to kill them. He's not afraid to do that. You know how many people came and perished because of that? Thank God, through their blood, the dripping blood, he opened the door. Heaven. One day, give me a cup of water, please. Give me a cup. One day, whether you obeyed him, whether you became a priest or a footballer, you wouldn't mind your child being a footballer. You wouldn't mind your child being a footballer because you worship money. But one day, whether you were a footballer or whether you were a priest or whether you were a rich man, whether you were poor, only one thing will matter: that Jesus Christ. Whether you know him, whether you have a car, only for me. Whether you had a house, whatever you had, will not matter. Today, I was preaching to the condemned prisoners at this one security prison. And I told them, it's better to go from Instagram condemned cells to heaven than to go from Lagoni estate directly to hell. And I called them and I said, bring me some water! Because the Bible says, and the poor man died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And then the rich man also died. I told them we are all condemned, only that we don't know our dates of condemnation. And we are all condemned to die. We are condemned to die. The few years I've got, then why not use it to serve my Jesus and to serve my God?
Send it. I told the prisoners today, I said that For somebody to come from Accra, Kolibu, to come and preach at his home is easier than for somebody to rise from Aludome Cemetery and wake up from the dead. That's why we have come to preach to them, to know Jesus. Let us understand the work of a priest as he kneels down praying. He's opening doors. He's opening doors as people are opening doors of evil.
See, fornication. Sometimes you sleep with one person, two people. But there is usually a particular person you sleep with, and he opens a particular door of spirits into your life. That's what people don't know. If you have slept with about 11 people, there is a particular person who Bible says, oh Babylon, the great has fallen and has become the habitation of devils because of the delicacies of her fornication. And thou hast lived deliciously and fornicated. But sometimes you see somebody that is that you can even sleep with about 3 or 4, but there's a particular moment the person is baptized to that person. It's like a certain gate has been opened. It's like I can sleep with anybody. I saw somebody where the person was saying, I want to sleep with 3 people at the same time. I want 3 men. He said, I want to lie down naked in front of 1,000 people. Evil spirits have entered. There are certain physical acts. That's why sometimes you can lay hands on something. This thing opens the door.
But we don't respect the office of a priest because it looks like he's just there. He's a fool.
In the church, we think that the priest is a fool. A normal person do such a job. If you have been to school, will you do such a job? He's a fool. We are brewing hot and cold. In one breath, you say, I like it. In the next breath, you say, stop it. Stop it, I like it. Stop it, I like it. Stop it, I like it. I enjoy it, but I don't want it. Hot and cold. Bitter and sweet. Praise it, Pastor! But I would never like to be you. Calling to a priest is a very, very high call. These are the two callings that Jesus swam in. He operated in the calling of a priest and the calling of a son. That's why he referred to himself as the Son of Man. And you always said, my Father. May you understand what it means to become a son. Because it's not easy to understand what to become a son is. Because we don't have good fathers on earth. Even our natural fathers, it's so difficult. And our earthly fathers are also fraught with weaknesses. So it's not easy to see fatherly anointing through the infirmities. It takes the grace of God to see what your father has done for you. Many people have to be talked to extensively before they appreciate your fathers. May God open your eyes to become a son. Tonight I just want to share just one key to becoming a son. To become a son, you must learn to appreciate all kinds of fathers. Amen. All fathers. Open your eyes and your heart to understand the role that fathers play in your life. And generally in the life, even in a nation. If you look at Kwame Nkrumah, was he the father of this nation? Is he the father of Ghana? Huh? In a way. You recognize that since Kwame Nkrumah left, it's been about 45 years, 47 years, before we are beginning to extend the Temamoto way, there is no road in the whole nation like the Temamoto way. 21 kilometers of dual carriageway going and dual carriageway coming. Since it was finished, not even 1 kilometer of such a road has been added to our trunk roads in this country. We cannot go from Accra to Cape Coast, Accra to Kumasi, Accra to Aflao, Accra to Koforidua on such a road. Since he built Akosombo Dam, which dam has been built again? Feasibility study. Pastor Eddie, he was doing feasibility studies in VRA. Pre-feasibility studies. Not only feasibility, but pre-feasibility, before the feasibility. Pastor Eddie, when were you working at VRA?
1993.
So 1993, 1992, they were doing pre-feasibilities for the Guida, is it Guida? White water, green, and so on, black water. We are still here doing studies. But somebody was able to build it in 1960 something. But you see, it's not easy to see a father because of his mistakes. And because of his mistakes, he must die. After he's dead, then we say we compromise him. We have compromised parties. It is stupendous. But that is the nature of that. Most, I was talking to some people, whilst their father was looking after, they never liked him. But not knowing, he was a good father when he's gone. Even my wife, I have constantly pointed out to her, your father is a very good father. Constantly. And she said to me that it is because of what you've been saying about him that I have begun to see so many good things about him. I always point out, even me, I learned from one of the things I learned from my father-in-law was no debts. I watched him in other areas. I won't tell you that areas. I'll tell some people about not. But you see, until you start to admire fathers in general, the father can be right in front of you like that. Oh, nah. A pastor can be in front of your father, you will never see it. You will never enjoy it. And when he's gone, maybe even that cry, you won't even see it. That's one of the stuff that you don't even see. So learn to be a son. If you want to be a son, John chapter 5 should be one of the key verses of your life, chapters of your life. Because in John chapter 5, Jesus refers to his father and describes his relationship with his father. He said, my father works and I work. In other words, what I receive, I do nothing except I see my father doing. He had a certain way of relating with his father. And he describes it very accurately in John chapter 5. May you learn to be a good son. May you open your eyes. Don't wait till you are now old and you also have children and your children are also facing you and you say, I now see what my father went through. There is a poem, I've written a new book called My Father, My Father. At the beginning of that book, I've written a poem. I don't know who the author is. But in the poem, it's somebody who grew up and the person said, when I was growing up, I used to come into your arms and you used to hold me. And I thought everything was okay. But as I have grown up, I have come to see that the world was a very wild and insecure world. And you were probably going through so many things. But as you were holding me, I didn't even know what you were also going through just to provide stability for me. But now that I have grown up, I realize that it was not easy for you. It probably must not have been easy for you. Some of you have cursed your fathers. Because your mother has told you bad things about your father, or the way your mother looks normal and the way she cries, you feel that your father is a very bad person. Now one day you grow up There's another side to the story. And you see. Look, Jesus said, I'm preaching to preach. Jesus said, woman, behold thy son. That's your son. And he said, behold thy mother. I'm telling you, who is your mother? I'm telling you, who is your mother? This is the highest calling. No other higher calling can be bestowed than to become a real son, a real child of God, or of whoever you are supposed to be a child of. I'm going to show you the blessings becoming a son. I'm going to read to you. Are you there? Are you there? In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, it says, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Are you listening? I'm about to read to you a stupendous verse. It's a stupendous verse. Listen up. He said, for he received from God the Father honor and glory. Honor and glory. When there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Jesus received honor and glory when his father said, this is my son. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Oh, you are not getting what I'm saying. I said, Jesus received honor and glory. You see, when we can all, you can call somebody Papa, Daddy, Papa, Dada, Daddy, and they can call you son, this and that and that. But you see, when a time comes when the thing is coming in accuracy and truth, and said, this is my son. This is my son, in whom I'm well pleased. He said that, for he received from the God the Father honor and glory. This is honor and this is glory for somebody to be able to say, this is my son, or this is my daughter, in whom I'm well pleased. Huh? Then you have received honor.
Amen.
And glory.
Amen.
May you receive honor.
Amen.
May you receive glory.
Amen.
And this voice which came from heaven, we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount. May such a voice be spoken. I mean, me, I will wish God would say that this is my son. And I am pleased with him. Amen. May your father tell you one day, this is a real son that I have. This is a real daughter that I am. Not just a son, but in whom I am well. I'm very happy. Have you seen a son when his father sees, becomes himself comes? He becomes happy. Sometimes on this earth we cannot please our earthly parents. But most of our parents came out of the world. We didn't know God. I remember when I came into ministry. My father wasn't pleased with me. I didn't make him happy. That was not his dream for me. This is not my father's dream. My father had other dreams for me. And I'm sure even if he was alive today, even though the church has worked and gone, he would still not be very happy. He was happy, but he was not happy. He was happy that I was a pastor in this school. He said, to my son, Reverend, Doctor, then he was writing the Reverend in it. On my wedding day, he said, look, and he was crying. He said, my son, when he was born, I gave him up to God. I said, Lord, if you like him to be a priest, let him be a priest. So he was happy that I was a priest, but at the same time, he was not at what a pope. I couldn't please him, but I want to please my heavenly Father. It's my prayer. If only I can, I'll be happy. May you also be able to attain to such a calling, the calling of a son and the calling of a priest. In Jesus' name.